Hi, this is Manos Boulakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting section 15.1 of the manual of PCI on how to treat aorto-ostial lesions. There are two types of ostial lesions. They are the aorto-ostials, left main, right coronary, a saphenous vein graft, or an internal mammary or arterial graft. And there are also the branch ostial lesions, who are further down in the coronary tree. In this video, we'll talk about the aorto-ostial lesions. There are several parts of the percutaneous coronary intervention process that are special in patients with aorto-ostial lesions, and we'll cover each one of them. In terms of planning, monitoring, pharmacology, access, these are as per standard practice. Femoral and radial access are both acceptable. However, engagement is one area that can be fairly challenging in aorto-ostial lesions, the reason being that when there is engagement, the pressure can become dampened. And the problem with this is it can cause ischemia, especially if the vessel is the left main, but also in large right coronary arteries. And also, if contrast is injected, there is a possibility of causing a dissection on the ostium that may complicate the procedure. So it is important during the case to find ways to minimize dampening, and the first one is to keep the guide slightly disengaged and prevent the pressure dampening. There are different other techniques that we'll address in the next few slides. Again, intermittent disengagement is one way to do this, and this is an example. The guide is disengaged, then it's engaged briefly, for example, to deliver equipment down the coronary artery, and then it's disengaged again to allow perfusion to happen in the coronary artery, followed by engagement again, and so on and so forth. So intermittent disengagement minimizes the degree of ischemia and allows the procedure to proceed. This is best achieved by using the so-called independent hand technique, in which the right hand handles the balloon or stand advancement and the guide wire, whereas the left hand is used to manipulate the guide and either advance it or withdraw it, allowing engagement and disengagement. This technique is strongly recommended both for this, but also for standard PCI. In terms of guide catheters, AMBLADS are not preferred for right coronary artery ostial lesions because it's harder to manipulate, whereas GR4 are usually preferred. Another option to prevent dampening is to use small guide catheters or guide catheter extensions. A third one is to use a wire that is placed into the aorta, which does two things. One is it marks the location of the ostium and facilitates stent placement. The second is helps keep the guide outside of the ostium of the coronary artery. And this wire is called floating, or sometimes it's called sepal wire. Another option is to use side hole guides. Those guides should never be used in unprotected left main, because they can cause a false sense of security. Pressure appears to be okay from the side holes, but they can still be dampening and decreased perfusion that can be catastrophic in the left main. Also, even when side holes are used, there is still the possibility of dissection of the ostium if contrast is injected. And finally, another option is to use a device called the Ostial Pro that has four prongs that rest against the aortic wall and prevent the guide from entering deep into the ostium of the ostial lesions. This can be a problem engagement, especially in patients who have previous ostial stents that are protruding into the aorta. Those stents may make engagement challenging. In terms of angiography, as mentioned before, it is important to not inject when the pressure is dampened. That's when bad things can happen, such as coronary or aortocoronary dissections. So it's very important, like is standard practice, to look at the pressure waveform both before and after injection. If the blood pressure is dampened, then injection should not happen. Nitroglycerin should be used because sometimes engagement can cause spasm that can falsely appear as an ostial lesion. Injection should be minimized, especially when there is persistent dampening. If there is contrast retention in the vessel, which can happen when the guide is engaged, that should be relieved, otherwise that can lead to arrhythmia, such as ventricular fibrillation. And finally, one wants to determine where exactly is the ostium of the vessel using various landmarks, and then use those landmarks to place subsequent stents. In terms of wiring, one way to facilitate the procedure is to have the guide wire loaded into the guide catheter, and then the moment that the guide engages and there is pressure dampening, the wire is immediately advanced down the vessel, and then the wire helps stabilize the guide, and then the guide can be disengaged without losing the position and being able to engage and disengage at will. This is one way to call it hit and run, engage, get the wire down, and then get the guide back. Lesion preparation is very important in osteo lesions because many of them can be resistant. So excellent balloon expansion should be ascertained. Sometimes atherectomy is needed for heavily calcified lesions. For osteo lesions, it's best to use the rota wire extra support for a rotablator to minimize movement and have a coaxial guide position to minimize angulation. If there are kinks on the wire, angulations, that can potentially lead to either injury of the coronary artery or even sometimes fracture of the rota wire. In terms of orbital atherectomy, the safest technique is to insert the crown into the vessel, sometimes using the glide assist, and then atherectomize coming back instead of the other way forward, because going forward, with the crown being outside in the aorta, there can be an unconstricted spinning and that can cause injury of the ostium. How about stenting? These are the recommended steps for stenting osteo lesions. The first one is, again, engage, get the wire down, and then disengage the guide so there is no dampening. The stent is inserted while the guide is engaged, and then immediately after the stent is inserted, the guide is moved back. Then the stent is withdrawn until the proximal segment of the stent protrudes 1 to 2 millimeters into the aorta. And this is why it's important to know where the ostium is, either with injections or with previous landmarks. The reason for having 1 to 2 millimeters in the aorta is to ensure that the ostium is completely covered with the stent. After the position is confirmed, then the stent is deployed, and then the balloon is pulled back and it's inflated again at high pressure in an attempt to flare the ostium of the vessel. Then, to get the guide back in, the balloon is deflated and is used as a rail to get the guide back in. The balloon is removed, and then final injections are done. The independent hand technique is critical for being able to perform these maneuvers that require intermittent engagement and disengagement of the guide catheter. Once a stent is placed and protrudes into the aorta, it can potentially cause difficulties with equipment getting back in as they may hit the stent struts. So it's desired to flare the ostium of the stent. That can be done by withdrawing the stent balloon and inflating at high pressure. Another way to do this in a little more predictable and a little better way is by using the ostial flush balloon. Essentially, this is a balloon that has two balloons, a distal balloon that is sized 1:1 to the artery and that's placed inside the stent, and it has a proximal balloon that inflates at low atmospheres, and essentially what it does is it pushes the struts of the deployed stent against the aortic wall, which facilitates engagement and advancement of equipment through the stent. What can go wrong with stent? One thing is to miss the ostium, having the stent placed too deep into the vessel. The second is having the stent protrude too much back into the aorta. And the third is to have the stent being underexpanded, or the stent expands but then there is recoil, because these lesions can be very hard to dilate sometimes. So for the first two problems, the missing the ostium and the excessive stent overhang, the prevention is to ensure that the stent is placed optimally in the first place. This is done by using multiple projections, having a long stent so there's enough length to adjust and cover enough of the vessel. Sometimes, if there is too much cardiac movement, this can be done with breath hold or rapid pacing. Having a wire, the floating wire or PETA wire, can help nail the ostium. And then also there is the ostial bro device and the ZABO technique, which we'll discuss in a second. This is the example of the floating or sepal wire It marks the ostium and helps deliver the stent just protruding into the aorta from the ostium. The ZABO technique is one technique to facilitate nailing the ostium and avoid advancing it too deep into the vessel. To get this done, there is a wire going through the ostial lesion into the target vessel and a second wire that is floating into the aorta. That second wire is inserted through a proximal strut from the stent that is being delivered. So this technique does require to essentially deform slightly the stent for lifting the strut and advancing that floating wire back end through the back strut. And then the stent is advanced, and the wire that is in the aorta essentially prevents the stent from going too deep. Then the stent is deployed, and the wire in the aorta is removed, and this way there is a little stent overhang into the aorta, nicely covering the ostium. This is obviously a very elegant technique, but it does carry some risks, the most obvious being that because the stent is deformed, the risk of stent loss may be slightly increased. If things happen and the stent does not cover the ostium, then another stent may be needed. This is an example of a case in which the stent is placed into the ostial RCA lesion. You can see the guide being disengaged, and there's injection. The stent appears to be going all the way into the aorta, but then once IVUS is done, and IVUS is extremely useful to confirming both that the stent is well expanded and also that is covering the ostium, we can see on IVUS that there is the stent, but then as we move towards the ostium, this part of the vessel does not have a stent. So the stent actually missed the ostium, and IVUS is the best way to determine that. The solution is to place another short stent. That stent is protruding more proximal into the aorta from the previous stent. And then after this is done, IVUS is repeated. Chromaflow can be very useful for seeing the blood flow. And now we can see that the stent essentially goes all the way into the aorta. And this is confirmed by angiogram that shows nice backflow of contrast into the aorta. And this is an even more exaggerated example showing that the stent here is clearly all the way out in the aorta. So the ostium is perfectly covered, the stent is protruding out in the aorta, and there's no question that the ostium is covered. What happens if there is excessive stent overhang? Usually nothing much is done. The ostium is flared or the ostial flask balloon is used. Some people give prolonged DAPT given the stent struts being out in the aorta. And if there is excessive overhang, sometimes people will snare and pull the stent, but that obviously carries the risk of causing disruption of the vessel and dissection. If the stent is underexpanded or if there is recoil, the treatment is to use high pressure balloons, special balloons, laser, lithotripsy, or the very high pressure balloons. And specifically for recoil, if the stent expands but then collapses, sometimes using a peripheral stent with high radial force may be needed. This is an example of an ostial heavily calcified left main lesion from Dr. Butner. And that shows nice expansion with the balloon, but then the stent is placed and the stent is clearly recoiling, as shown in this picture. So a bigger renal stent is placed that has very high radial force, and that provided a very nice result with excellent flow into the left main. Final thing about assessing the severity of the lesion, physiology can be done. However, it's very important to ensure there is no dampening of the pressure. This is an example of an ostial RCA lesion. This is the FFR, and the FFR is 0.9, suggesting that this is not significant. However, if we look at the waveform is dampened in the aortic pressure. Now the guide is moved back out in the aorta, and now the aortic waveform looks great, and now the FFR is actually ischemic. So very important when doing FFR or any restic index for physiologic assessment of ostial lesions to ensure the guide is disengaged and there is no pressure dampening. And this is an example. The guide here is engaged and dampening. The FFR is artificially high, but then once the guide is disengaged, the FFR becomes lower, and this is a significant lesion. How much can the pressure change? That was a study showing that the average change with guide engagement is 0.05. By disengaging, the FFR came down nicely, and sometimes there was actually no obvious visible pressure dampening. We had a study in which we used side hole guides, and there was improvement, but still, when the guide came out, there was further reduction in the FFR. So to summarize, the aorto-ostial lesions can be challenging to treat. The key aspects is to minimize pressure dampening by having various techniques, usually intermittent engagement and disengagement, doing multiple projections to ensure that the ostium is well visualized, wiring early and then using the wire as a rail to insert and disengage the guide, carefully prepare the lesion to prevent their expansion, using stenting with the goal to have the stent protrude 1 to 2 millimeters into the aorta, and confirm that this is so with intravascular imaging. And finally, if coronary physiology is done, either with FFR or with resting indices, the guide should be disengaged to avoid having an artificially high FFR. Thank you.